Great to be here. Great to see you. Great to have you online if you're joining us online. And I know we all have different kinds of weeks going on. We didn't all have the same week. Some of you have had a phenomenal week. Some of you have had a really difficult week. And I want to take just a moment, pray for us, invite God to meet us in the middle of those things that we feel stressed out by or challenged by, and allow God to speak into our hearts today. So let's pray together. Father, we're just so thankful that we get this opportunity to worship together. And Lord, in this place, you invite us to connect with others, and you invite us to allow you to speak into our hearts. And Lord, you know the stuff going on for us, the stuff we're stressed out over, anxious about, things that are going good for us, things that are difficult for us. And Lord, I just pray that you would meet us at our point of need, whatever that might be today. Lord, we are grateful for this place, for the hope and promise found here as we gather. And today, Lord, we just want to honor you and give to you all the stuff that we're wrestling with. Father, we're grateful for Christ. We pray in his name. Amen. I was traveling this week, like a lot of weeks, and I was headed to Atlanta and got on the plane. We'd taken off, and I was working on my message for this weekend. And we're talking about failures aren't fatal. Our failures aren't fatal. And I was, we were about 5-7 minutes into the flight, and I was kind of figuring out what I was going to do to get things started. And there was this shutter in the plane, like, and if you were driving, you would have been convinced you actually hit something. Now, it wasn't like turbulence, you know, I've been in turbulence a lot. This was like the whole plane shook. And then we went on about another 2 minutes, and it did it again. The plane just shook, and this time we dropped some. And the only time you should ever be nervous on a plane is when the flight attendant looks nervous. And she was like up there looking around, you know, trying to be nonchalant about it. And then there was a little ding, and it was the pilot calling her. Never a good sign. And as I was watching her answer this phone, I knew things weren't going great up there, because she started getting like panicky about a few things. We went on a little bit further. The plane shook again. We dropped again. And the pilot came on, and he said, "Folks, we're having a little bit of a problem with the plane." Hey, didn't know that back here. And then he said, "Just want to let you know that our left engine has failed. It's stalled. But don't worry, these planes are rated to fly on one engine, and we're going to head back in." Well, now there's chatter on the plane, right? Everybody is nervous and paying attention, and I've perfected the art of not talking to people on the plane. Over the years, I've just figured out if they find out you're a pastor, one of two things happens. The first thing that happens is they look at you and go, "Oh, no, what have I said? What have I said? What have I said?" based on the earlier conversation. The second thing that happens, they say, "Oh, you're a pastor? My aunt's cat has a toe fungus." And it goes on like that for like hours. So I just like hunker down in my seat. But now we're chatting, and the guy next to me, and he's saying maybe we should pray. And you know, I honestly, you know, wasn't that concerned about it. And the pilot came on, and he said, "Not only is our plane rated to fly on one engine, but we've been trained to fly the plane on one engine. Code 4, this has never happened to me before. This is our first time too. And 20 years ago, I was in a simulator and we practiced this once." That's what that was. So we make our way back into the airport, and as we're coming in, the plane just kept, the engine just kept like starting and stalling and starting and stalling. It was a little bit bouncy coming back in. When we got close enough, I had decided to text Diane. I cheated and turned my phone off of airplane mode. And because she was in the gate next to me, and her flight was 2 hours later, and I knew we were going to be stuck there, and I was texting her to say maybe we should have lunch. "We're coming back. There's a small mechanical problem with our plane." What I didn't know was they'd rolled out the entire fire department. All the fire trucks were lined down there. Rescue crews were there. People running out of the airport with gears on. And Diane knew that was our plane coming in. Big mistake. Don't do that again. Created some excitement. Our failures aren't fatal. I thought it fit with the message perfectly today. You know, one of the things that happens to us is we get stuck in our bustedness. We get stuck in our choices that didn't go well or we didn't like or something about us that didn't work. Our failures often for us seem fatal. Like we're never going to get past that. We're never going to get beyond that. And certainly God can't care for us. Now, last weekend, we had a great Easter celebration and watching all those baptisms. And Matt did a terrific job of unpacking the hope that comes through the resurrection of Jesus. That God wants to trade you. And I hope you got your red paper clip. And as a reminder that God is inviting you to trade up. Did you get to trade all your brokenness and your past and your guilt and all the shame that goes with that? All the stuff that we've been dragging on. And God wants to trade you for freedom and hope and peace and grace and life. And last weekend, Easter, is the big deal day, right, for the followers of Jesus. Because Jesus had been put to death, and they didn't think anything was going to happen. They had heard him say, there's going to be a Messiah. I'm the one who's come to redeem and restore. But they thought it was going to be an earthly kingdom. They thought that Israel was going to be freed out of Rome. They thought they were going to get to be part of this whole revival and maneuver that was going on to restore Israel. And now, Jesus is dead. But then Sunday comes, and everything changes. And it would be 50 days after Easter, 50 days where the disciples get up in the city of Jerusalem, and it's Peter who preaches the first message of the church, and the church launches. And here we are 2,000 years later, and the church exploded. Billions of people have found hope and grace past their failures through this resurrected Jesus. And I love watching this emboldened Peter who spoke that first message and 3,000 people got baptized. Can you imagine that day standing near the baptistry? What an amazing moment happens. Peter goes on to be this terrific leader. But in the very last recorded scene that we have with Jesus and Peter where there's a conversation, Peter is a hulking failure. He made a huge mistake. And he was convinced he was never going to get beyond that mistake. If you have your Bibles, I want to invite you to turn to John in your New Testament. John is one of the gospel writers. The gospels tell us the story of Jesus. It's about 3/4 of the way through your Bible on your phone. Go to John chapter 21, the very last chapter of John. And here's the scene that unfolds. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. And it happened like this. Simon Peter and Thomas and Nathanael and sons of Zebedee and 2 other of the disciples were together. Peter said, I'm going to go fishing. We'll go with you. So they went out and they got into the boat, but that night they didn't catch anything. Now Peter and several of these others had been commercial fishermen before they started following Jesus. What they did for a trade was how they earned their living. And this wasn't one of those commercial fishing trips. This wasn't one where they're going, well, you know, Jesus is gone, and we don't know really what's going to happen. Now he's resurrected. We've seen him twice, but we don't really know how to make sense of this. Maybe we should get our old jobs back. It wasn't that kind of fishing trip. I think for Peter, it was because he went to what he knew, what he was comfortable with, what he was familiar. Because a lot of times when we blow, when we make mistakes, we end up heading back to what's comfortable or familiar. So here he is sitting in the boat. 3 years had passed since he'd become one of Jesus' disciples. And there were some amazing high spots for Peter. There were some incredible moments where Peter, this fisherman, now becomes one of the bolder leaders, the one of closest friends to Jesus. Peter was strong. He was also vocal and quick to offer up an opinion, and sometimes it got him in trouble. One time, Jesus and his followers were together. In fact, it happened just before we get to the final week of Jesus' life. It's not long before this when Jesus is up away from Jerusalem, out in a remote area, and he's gathered with the disciples, and he says to them, who do people say that I am? Well, you know, at this point, Jesus' popularity, this is like midway through his ministry, the popularity is growing, And the people are loving him. The crowds are showing up. They're wanting to hear what he has to say about how to love God and connect with God. Now, the religious leaders, the people in charge, the Pharisees, we call them, they didn't like this at all. They didn't like what Jesus was saying. They didn't like how he was responding. He wasn't who they thought he should be as a Messiah or a Savior. They thought he should be put to death. So now you got crowds showing up, immensely popular, and all the authorities looking to arrest him. So Jesus says, who do people say that I am? And the disciples respond, well, the polls are saying, some think you're Moses or Elijah or one of the prophets. And then Jesus asks this question, but who do you say that I am? What is it you have to say? And it's Peter who speaks. And he says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And here's what Jesus says to him. Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this wasn't revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter. And that word means rock. And on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. Here is this powerful moment. If you're Peter, you spoke these bold words about Jesus, and Jesus blesses you and says to you, Peter, upon that confession, upon that acknowledgement, I'm going to call you Peter now. You're a rock. You're standing strong. And on that confession, I'm going to build my church, and all of hell won't prevail against it. I mean, if you're Peter, there's not a better moment in your life. And you're the one going, man, I am your guy. I'm going to hang with you. I'm going to stand with you. Then we get to the week before Easter. Jesus and his followers go into Jerusalem. And as they're coming in, they're coming for the Feast of the Passover. Think Thanksgiving. It was a massive celebration for the entire country of Israel. And you would go often to your hometown. And if you could get to Jerusalem, it was kind of the Mecca for you. You would go to Jerusalem. So Jesus and his followers are going there. When they come in the city, the crowds are chanting that Jesus is their king. And he's the one that's going to save them. I mean, they are riding high. But in the middle of that dinner, when they're gathered in that upper room, Jesus says to his followers, one of you is going to betray me. I love how the scripture tells us they went around the table saying, Lord, is it me? Am I the one? But not when they get to Peter. Remember, Peter's bold and he's impetuous. And it's Peter who says, I will never, ever do that. The rest of these schmucks sit it on. And why we're all sitting on one side of the table that the picture show, I don't know. But all of these people, that was a joke, by the way. All of these people, they may fail you, but not me. I'm the one that's going to stand. I'll be the one who's firm. And here's what Jesus says to him. I tell you, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you're going to deny three times that you know me. Before the sun comes up, Peter, you're going to deny you know me. They leave that supper. They go out to a familiar area where they often gathered, the Garden of Gethsemane. It's up on one of the hillsides looking down into the city of Jerusalem. And when you read the Gospels, if you read that part of the story, you see Jesus in incredible anxiousness. You see him just stressed over what's coming because he knows what he's about to do. He's about to follow his Father's command to take on all the sins. He was going to be that perfect lamb, that sacrifice. Matt talked about that last week, what Jesus did on the cross for us. And he knows all of that is coming. And sometime in the middle of the night, there's some torches coming up the hill. Judas breaks out of the group, walks over to Jesus and kisses him on the cheek, a sign of greeting. And the soldiers arrest Jesus. They haul him down the hill, and the rest of the disciples follow at a bit of a distance, and then here's what happens next. Peter followed, and when some there had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard, and they had sat down together, Peter sat down with them. A servant girl saw him seated there in the firelight. She looked closely at him and said, this man was with Jesus. But Peter denied it. Woman, I don't know him, he said. A little later, someone else saw him and said, you're also one of them. You were one of his followers. Man, I'm not. I don't know him. About an hour later, another one asserted, certainly this fellow was with him, for he's a Galilean. And Peter replied, I don't know what you're talking about. And just as he was speaking, the rooster crowed. And the Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. And Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him before. The rooster crows today. You're going to disown me three times, and he went outside and he wept bitterly. Epic fail. This rock was now crumbling. The very thing he'd promised he wouldn't do, now he'd folded like a cheap tent. They ask who he is, and Peter said, I don't know him. I wasn't with him. Never met him. Don't know him. And he does it the third time. And then he and Jesus lock eyes and the rooster crows. And the guilt that went, there was more than one betrayer that night. Judas did it with a kiss. Peter did it with his words. And now Jesus is put on trial and he's beaten. And then he's forced to carry his own cross. And crucifixion is most horrific form of punishment that man's enacted against man. It was designed as a slow death. As an example, Jesus is dragging his own cross out to a hillside. Then he's nailed to it. And then he breathes his last. And if you were one of the followers of Jesus, every hope you had, every dream that you thought, everything you anticipated was going to happen, now just ended. It was over. Friday turns into Saturday. Saturday turns into Sunday. The clock is grinding. It is slow. If you've ever really blown it, if you've ever made a mistake, if you've experienced a great loss or a deep sorrow or some horrific thing has happened, you know how slow the clock goes. The disciples, the followers are confused. They get Sunday morning. And some of them go to the cemetery. Luke 24 tells us this part. And they go there in their grief. They go there as a place to mourn. And an angel appears to them and says, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here. He's risen, remember? Remember what he said to you while he was with you in Galilee? That the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinners and be crucified and on the third day be raised again?" And then they remembered what Jesus said. And when they came back from the tomb, they told this to the other disciples. And here's how they responded. They didn't believe the women because their words seemed to them like nonsense. One of the evidences for Scripture for me, when I came to faith, one of those evidences was that nobody who was with Jesus thought that the resurrection was going to happen. None of them, like, were going, "Well, hey, guys, hang out because wait till Sunday. I mean, things are going to get better on Sunday." They didn't believe him. In fact, here's what Peter does. He gets up and he runs to the tomb, and bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away wondering to himself what had happened. What in the world happened here? But now we're a few days later. John chapter 21. Peter's sitting in a boat, floating on a sea of regret. Jesus has appeared to him two times already. We're going to learn that now this one will be the third time when it happens here in a moment. But Peter doesn't know. He doesn't know how this is going to go. He doesn't know what to think about this. He doesn't know if somehow now he's excluded himself. He doesn't know what Jesus is going to say or do. He doesn't know what the response is going to be. All he knows is he did what he said he wasn't going to do, and he couldn't undo it. The egg had been scrambled. The milk had been poured. There was nothing he could do. You know, I've been doing the people thing a long time, and here's what I know for a whole bunch of us, that we live with our failures as a point that we're convinced that somehow we cannot fix that. We cannot resolve that. God, he isn't going to forgive us of that. I know he forgives others, but man, you don't know what I did. Peter's in the boat, and he's replaying it over in his head. Have you ever done that? The thing you did or said that if I just hadn't gone there, if I just hadn't done this, if I just hadn't made that choice. You know what I think most of us need to do in this room is we need to quit hoping for a better past. Because you're not going to get one. What happened, happened. And it happened here. And Peter is stuck. Here's how the story unfolds. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples, they didn't realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Hey, friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. "Throw your net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some." And when they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of a large number of fish. When you read the Gospels, that's exactly how some of these fishermen first met Jesus in the first place, was on a fishing trip, where they caught so many fish, and they left those nets, and they'd spent 3 years with them, but now here they are rocking in a boat. "It's the Lord." And Peter, when he heard that, the scripture says, as soon as Peter heard it, he jumped into the water, did his best Michael Phelps toward Jesus. He swam into the shore, and the other disciples followed him in with the boat. I love this for Peter. He isn't waiting
But he's not sure exactly what's going to happen when he gets there. Can you imagine as he's swimming toward shore, the closer he's getting, he's wondering, whoa, you know, maybe. Have you ever gotten like in a fight with a boss or a friend or, you know, Diane and I got a really, you know, one of those fights. And it was my fault, as most of ours were. And you know, when you're like after the fight, when you're still right and they're wrong, and you know when you see that other person again, how awkward that is, how that feels. You know, think about it. I said to Diane one time, I wouldn't marry you again if you were the last woman on the face of the planet. And she said, I know you wouldn't. You'd get killed in the stampede. You know, the reality is, but you know those moments, can you imagine what this was like for Peter, anxious to, like, I want to be there, but I don't know if I want to be there. I want to hear what he has to say, but I don't know if I want to hear what he has to say. I want to get close, but I don't want to be too close. Because I don't know what's going to happen. Because I did what I said I wouldn't do. And for most of us, our failures seem fatal. But here's what happens. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. None of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. And this was now the third time that Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. I love this. I love this. No great philosophical discussion. No, like rehearsing the past. Like, hey, man, how many times did I have to tell you guys? That's coming back. No, like to-do list. You know, hey, by the way, I've got to go see the high priest and the Caiaphas because, you know, they were the ones who put me to death. I thought I'd go see. Hey, this was, let's have breakfast. Do you know in the Bible, when you trace Jesus' steps, he was often on his way to a meal, coming from a meal or at a meal, because in his day, a meal meant you are valued to me. I find significance in you. And now here he is having breakfast. Jesus wasn't offended. He was redemptive. Jesus wasn't lecturing. He was extending grace. Jesus wasn't beating them up. Jesus was saying, bet you guys are hungry. There is redemption and hope that comes through the resurrected Jesus. And your failures are not fatal, although for so many of us, we live with our failures. But according to the Bible, those failures aren't fatal. Watch this video.
Such a feeling's coming over me. There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky, got the sun in my eyes, and I won't be surprised if it's a dream. I'm on the top of the world.
This is the end. Beautiful friend, this is the end, my only friend, the end of our elaborate plans. The
because of the resurrection, your failures aren't fatal. You don't get stuck in your past. You don't have to live with the guilt of that. Look what Peter went on to do from this point. In fact, I'd invite you to read maybe the rest of today or later today or this week sometime. Read the end of John chapter 21. Because eventually Jesus says to Peter, hey, Peter, do you love me? Peter says, you know I do. Peter, do you love me? Yes, I do. Peter, do you love me? He's kind of irritated. Three times he gets asked, how many times did he deny Jesus? And Jesus restored him and said, come and follow me. And here's what Peter does. Like 48 days later, Peter is the one who stands up in Jerusalem and says to them, this same Jesus whom you crucified, God has made both Lord and Christ. And 3,000 people are baptized. It's Peter who becomes a missionary. It's Peter who becomes a church planter. It's Peter who becomes this phenomenal leader martyred for his faith. Why? Because of the resurrection and hope and promise of Jesus. Because Peter figured out, I can get past my past because God has. Who you run to is way more important than what you're running from. Because a whole lot of us in the room are running from some stuff. Things in our past that marked us, shaped us. Some of it created havoc for us. Some of it created grief for us. Some of it created broken relationships for us. Some of it is stuff that we thought we could never, ever get past this. We dragged that bag of rocks with us, all the woulda, coulda, shouldas, all the regrets. And we float in our own boats with our heads hung. Do you know the difference between Peter and Judas? I meet a lot of people named Peter. I've never met anybody named Judas. And you know the difference between those two? Both of them betrayed Jesus. One did it with a kiss, one with his words. Both of them were grief-stricken after they did it, guilty. Both of them, the Bible says, went and wept bitterly for their choice. The only difference between those two is that Peter believed God could do something with that awful moment, and Judas believed that God could not. There are a whole lot of us that need to quit hoping for a better past, because you're not going to get one. We were on vacation with all of our family back in January. We were playing some games with the grandkids, and I don't know what we were playing, but one of them, you know, messed up. It didn't go right and said, I want a do-over. And we gave him one. I don't know why we did that, but we do. You know how that works. Remember when you were a kid, you got a do-over, like, get to fix that again. Well, one of my grandsons was upset because he didn't think to ask for a do-over on his thing. So he started crying. I went over and said, suck it up. Life goes like this. I didn't. I was kinder than that, but. You know, a lot of us want to get a do-over. And here's the fascinating thing in the Bible. God isn't giving you a do-over necessarily. Because whatever you did happened. Whatever consequences of that happened in your life, those are real. However it marked you and shaped you, that's a reality you got to live with. The things you wish you could change, most of that's happened. Now, we can ask for forgiveness, and we can work at reconciliation, and we can try to redeem some of that, but the truth is, what you did, you did. But in the resurrected Jesus, you get to trade up. You get to trade up for new hope and new promise. You get to get past your guilt. In the resurrected Jesus, you get promise. In the resurrected Jesus, you get hope. In the resurrected Jesus, you get past your past. And God is inviting every one of us to run to him. Because who you run to is always more important than what you run from. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your grace and the hope and promise and goodness that we find in you and from you and through you. And Lord, I pray that as we gather in this place, we're reminded of that hope. We're reminded of what you did for us. And Lord, I'm so thankful that you've allowed me to cut loose that bag of rocks that I've drugged through so much of my life, because in Jesus, there is forgiveness, there is grace, and there is freedom. And so Lord, in this place, help me to be reminded of that. Lord, that stuff we hang on to, all the woulda, coulda, shouldas, the sea of regret we float on, all the ways we hang our head and wish it wasn't like it had been. You bring resurrection. When we give our hearts and our lives to you and come out of that water, Lord, you bring hope and new life and new promise and a new day. And so we're thankful. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I really want to encourage you to take a next step. You know, one of the things that LifeBridge cares about is helping you on your journey. For some of us, the next step is just to keep asking some questions, keep showing up and trying to sort if any of this fits or is real or can work for you. For some, your next step is to give your hearts and your lives to Christ, to take a next step in baptism, to take a next step and connect with some others, to take a next step in a group, to take a next place step where you're serving. More than anything, around here, people want you to connect with the goodness of God and find the power of the resurrected Jesus in our lives and our hearts. We're going to share in a time of communion now. And communion is just a reminder. It's what Jesus did on that last night with his followers. He said, take this bread as you eat it and remember me, and take this cup of juice as you drink it and remember me. And it was the broken body and the shed blood of Jesus on the cross when that Friday was so ugly and so terrible. And we get stuck in our Fridays, don't we? All those Friday moments of our lives when we think it's done and we're not good and we can't fix this. And he brings it with the resurrection and hope and promise that comes in an Easter. And you know, the best part about Easter is it's actually every day, because God's inviting me to find that grace in him. So use this time as a reminder of that. If you're not ready to take communion, just use this as a time of reflection as we magnify Jesus, our Lord and Savior.